fair Hippolyta, our nuptial hour draws on apace. 4 happy days bring in a new moon, but oh, methinks how slow this old moon wanes. She lingers my desires like to a stepdame or a dowager, long withering out a young man's revenue.
4 days will quickly steep themselves in night. 4 nights will quickly dream away the time. And then the moon, like to a silver bow new bent in heaven, shall behold the night of our solemnities.
Philostrate, go, stir up the Athenian youth to merriments. Awake the pert and nimble spirit of mirth. Turn melancholy forth to funerals. The pale companion is not for our pomp. Hippolyta, I wooed thee with my sword and won thy love, doing thee injuries. But I will wed thee in another key, with pomp, with triumph, and with reveling.
Happy be Theseus, our renowned duke.
Thanks, good Aegeus. What's the news with thee?
Full of vexation come I with complaint against my child, my daughter Hermia. Stand forth, Demetrius. My noble lord, this man hath my consent to marry with my daughter. Stand forth, Lysander. My gracious duke, this man hath bewitched the bosom of my child. Thou, Lysander, thou hast given her rhymes and interchanged love tokens with my child. Thou hast by moonlight at her window sung with feigning voice verses of feigning love, so that she will not hear before your grace consent to marry with Demetrius. I beg the ancient privilege of Athens. As she is mine, I can dispose of her how I see fit, which shall be either to this gentleman or to her death, according to our law, immediately provided in that case.
What say you, Hermia? Be advised, fair maid, Demetrius is a worthy gentleman.
So is Lysander.
Himself he is. But wanting your father's voice, the other must be held the worthier.
Would my father looked but with my eyes.
Rather with your eyes must with his judgment look.
Do entreat your grace to pardon me. I know not by what power I am made bold, nor how it may concern my modesty. Such presence here to plead my thoughts. But I beseech your grace that I may know the worst that may befall me in this case if I refuse to wed Demetrius.
Either to die the death, or to abjure forever the society of men. Therefore, fair Hermia, question your desires, know of your youth, examine well your blood. For, if you yield not to your father's choice, you can endure the livery of a nun. For I, to be in shady cloister mewed, to live a barren sister all your life, chanting faint hymns to the cold, fruitless moon.
So will I grow. So live, so die, my lord. Ere I will yield my virgin patent up unto his lordship whose unwished yoke. My soul consents not to give sovereignty.
Take time to pause. And by the next new moon, the sealing day betwixt my love and me, for everlasting bond of fellowship, upon that day, if you yield not to your father's will, you can die the death, or else to wed Demetrius.
Relent, sweet Hermia, and Lysander. Yield thy grace title to my certain right.
You have her father's love, Demetrius. Let me have Hermia's. Do you marry him?
Scornful Lysander. True, he hath my love, and what is mine, my love shall render him. And as she is mine, and all my right of her, I do estate unto Demetrius.
I am, my lord, as well derived as he, as well possessed. My love is more than his. I am beloved of beauteous Hermia. Why not I then to prosecute my right? And Demetrius, I'll avouch it to his head, made love to Nestor's daughter Helena, and won her soul. And she, sweet lady, dotes, devoutly dotes in idolatry upon this spotted and inconstant man.
I must confess that I've heard as much, and to have thought Demetrius to have spoke thereof. But being overfull of self affairs, my mind did lose it. But come, Demetrius, and come, Aegeus, you shall go with me. I have some private schooling for you both. For you, fair Hermia, look you fit your fancies to your father's will, else the law of Athens yields you up, to death or to a vow of single life.
With duty and desire we follow you.
Hippolyta.
How now, my love? Why is your cheek so pale? How chance the roses there do fade so fast?
Be like for want of rain, which I could well beteem them from the tempest of my eyes.
Ay, me, for aught that I could ever read, could ever hear by tale or by history, the course of true love never did run smooth, but either it was difference in blood.
Cross too high to be enthralled to low.
Or else misgraft in respect of years.
Oh, spite too old to be engaged to young.
Or else it stood upon the choice of friends.
Oh, hell to choose love by another's eyes.
Hear me, Hermia. I have a widow aunt, a dowager of great revenue, and she hath no child. From Athens is her house remote 7 leagues, and she respects me as her only son. There, gentle Hermia, will I marry thee. And to that place the sharp Athenian all cannot pursue us. If thou lovest me, then steal forth thy father's house tomorrow night, and in the wood, a league without the town, while I wait for thee.
Good Lysander, I swear to thee by Cupid's strongest bow. Same place thou hast appointed me, tomorrow truly will I meet with thee.
Keep promise, love. Look, here comes Helena.
Godspeed, fair Helena. Whither away?
Call you me fair? That fair again unsay. Demetrius loves your fair. Your eyes are lodestars, and your tongue sweet air, more tunable than lark, to shepherd's ear when wheat is green, when hawthorn buds appear. Oh, sickness is catching, or favor so yours would I catch, fair Hermia, ere I go. Oh, teach me how you look, and with what art you sway the motion of Demetrius's heart.
I frown upon him, yet he loves me still.
That your frowns would teach my smile such skill.
I give him curses, yet he gives me love.
That my prayers could such affection move.
The more I hate, the more he follows me.
The more I love, the more he hateth me.
This folly, Helena, is no fault of mine.
None but your beauty. Would that fault were mine.
Take comfort, he no more shall see my face. Lysander and myself shall fly this place. Before the time I did Lysander see, seemed Athens as a paradise to me. Then what graces in my love do dwell, that he hath turned a heaven unto a hell.
Helen, to you our minds we will reveal. Through Athens' gates have we devised to steal.
And in the woods where you and I, upon faint primrose beds were wont to lie, emptying our bosoms of their counsel sweet, there my Lysander myself shall meet. Thence from Athens turn away our eyes, seek new friends and stranger companies. Farewell, sweet playfellow. Pray thou for us. Good luck grant thee thy Demetrius. Keep word, Lysander. We must starve our sight. Lover's food tomorrow deep midnight.
I will, Hermia. Helen. Adieu. As you on Demetrius, he dotes on you.
How happy some or other some can be. Through Athens I am thought as fair as she, but what of that? Demetrius thinks not so. He will not know what all but he do know. And as he errs, doting on Hermia's eyes, so I, admiring of his qualities. Things base and vile, holding no quantity, love can transpose to form and dignity. Love looks not with the eyes, but with the mind, and therefore is winged Cupid painted blind. I will tell Demetrius of Hermia's flight. Then to the wood will he tomorrow night pursue her. And for this intelligence, if I have thanks, it is a dear expense. But herein mean I to enrich my pain, to have his sight thither and back again.
Is all our company here?
You were best to call them, generally, actor by actor, according to the script.
Oh, here is the list of every man's name which is thought fit through all Athens to play in our interlude before the Duke and the Duchess on their wedding day at night.
First, good Mrs. Quince. Say what the play treats on, then read the names of the actors, and so grow to a point.
Mary, our play is the most lamentable comedy and most cruel death of Pyramus and Thisbe.
Ugh, ew.
A very good piece of work, I assure you, and a Mary. Now, Mrs. Quince, call forth your actors. Masters, spread yourselves.
Answer as I call you. Nick Bottom, the weaver.
Ready! Name what part I am for in Pyramus. And proceed.
You, Nick Bottom, are set down for Pyramus.
What is Pyramus? A lover or a tyrant?
A lover that kills himself most gallant for love.
That will ask some tears in the true performing of it. Mm-hmm. If I do it, I'm doing it. Let the audience look to their eyes, I shall move storms. I will condole in some measure to the rest.
Francis flew.
Yet my chief humor is that of a tyrant. I can play Ursula's rarely, or part to Terracadden, to make all split.
Francis flute.
Raging rocks and shivering shocks shall break the locks of prison gates. Amphibious cars shall shine from far and make and mar the foolish fates. This was lofty. Now name the rest of the players.
Francis
flute. This was Ursula's vein. A tyrant's vein. A lover is more condoled.
Francis flute, the bellows mender.
Here, Mrs. Quint.
Flute. You must take Thisbe on you.
Oh, and what is Thisbe? A wandering knight?
No, it is the lady that Pyramus must love.
Nay, Faith, let me not play a woman. I have a beard coming in.
Oh, it's all one. You shall play it in a mask, and you will speak as small as you will.
And I shall hide my face. Let me play Thisbe, too. I will speak in a monstrous little voice. Thisbe!
Pyramus, my lover dear!
Thy Thisbe dear and lady dear!
No, you must play Pyramus and flute, you Thisbe.
Well, proceed.
Robin Starveling, the tailor.
Here, Mrs. Quince.
Robin Starveling, you must play Thisbe's mother. Snap the tinker.
Here, Miss Quince.
You, Pyramus's father. Myself, Thisbe's father. And Snug the joiner, you the lion's part. And I hope here is a play well fit.
Oh, have you the lion's part written? Pray you, if it be, give it to me, for I am slow of study.
You may do it extempore, for it's nothing but roaring.
And I shall play the lion, too. I will roar that I will do man's heart good to hear me roar. I will roar that I will hear the Duke say, let him roar again.
And you should do
let
it.
Let him.
And
roar.
And you should do it too terribly. You'd fright the Duchess and the ladies that they would shriek, and that were enough to hang us all.
I grant you, friends, you should fright the ladies out of their wits, then they'd have no more discretion but to hang us. But, I will aggravate my voice. So I will roar you as gently as any suckling dove. I will roar you to any nightingale.
You may play no part but Pyramus.
Bottom, right.
For Pyramus is a sweet-faced man. A proper man, as one shall see on a summer's day. A most sweet, gentlemanlike man. Therefore, you must play Pyramus.
Well, I will undertake it. What beard were I best to play it in?
Why, what you will.
I'll discharge it in your straw-colored beard. Your orange, tawny beard, oh! Your purple and grain beard, or your French crown-colored beard.
Some of your French crowns have no hair at all, and then you will play barefaced. But masters, here are your parts, and I am to entreat you, request you, and desire you to con them by tomorrow night, and meet me in the palace wood a mile without the town by moonlight. There will we rehearse, for if we meet in the city, we will be dogged with company and our devices known. In the meantime, I will draw a bill of properties such as our play wants. I pray you fail me not.
There we will rehearse. And there we will meet most obscenely and courageously. Take pains. Be perfect. Adieu.
At the Duke's Oak we meet.
Enough. Hold or cut bowstrings.
We'll be right back. now, spirit, whither wander you?
Over hill, over dale, thorough bush, thorough briar, over park, over pale, thorough flood, thorough fire, I do wander everywhere, swifter than the moon's sphere, and I serve the fairy king to do his orbs upon my wing. The cowslips tall his pensioners be, in those gold coats, spots, you see, those be rubies, fairy favors. In their freckles live their savors, I must go seek some dewdrops here, and hang a pearl in every cowslip's ear. Farewell, thou lava spirits. I shall be gone. The king and all elves come here anon.
No, wait. Will the queen doth keep her rebels here tonight? And take heed your king come not within her sight, for Titania is passing fell in wrath, because that he, as his attendant hath, a lovely boy, stolen from an Indian king. He never had so sweet a changeling. And jealous Titania would have the child, queen of her train, to trace the forest while, but he perforce withholds a loved boy. Crowns him with flowers, makes him all his joy. And now they never meet in grove nor green, a fountain clear or spangled starlight sheen, but they do square. And all of their elves, for fear, creep into acorn cups and hide them there.
Either I mistake your shape, and making quite, or you are that shrewd and knavish sprite called Robin Goodfellow. Are you not he?
Thou speakest aright. I am that merry wanderer of the night. Well, I jest to Titania and make her smile, when I a fat and bean-fed horse beguile, neighing in the likeness of a filly foal. And sometime lurk I in a gossip's bowl, and wax in their mirth, and knees and swear. Well, Mary, your hour was never wasted there. Oh. Room, fairy, here comes Titania.
And I, my master, were that she were gone.
Ill met by moonlight proud Oberon.
Oh, what, jealous Titania? Fairy, skip hence. I have forsworn her bed and company.
Oh, tarry, rash wanton, am I not thy lady? Well,
then I must be thy lord. But I know when thou hast stolen away from fairyland, playing on pipes of corn and versing sweet love to amorous Philidus. Why art thou here? Your buskined master and warrior love are to be wedded, and you come to bring their bed joy and prosperity?
How canst thou thus for shame, Oberon? Glance at my credit with Theseus, knowing I know thy love to Hippolyta.
These are the forgeries of jealousy. And never, since middle summer spring, met we in dale, forest, or mead, by paved fountain or rushy brook, or by the beached margent of the sea, to dance our ringlets to the whistling wind. With thy brawls thou hast disturbed our sport. Therefore the winds, piping to us in vain, as in revenge, have sucked up from the sea contagious fogs, which falling in the land have every pelting river made so proud that they have overborne their continents. The ox hath therefore stretched his yoke in vain. The plowman lost his sweat, and the green corn hath rotted ere his youth attained a beard. The fold stands empty in the drowned field. The crow is fatted with the marine flock. The nine men's morris is filled up with mud, and the quaint mazes in the wanton green, for lack of tread, are indistinguishable. Human mortals want their winter here. No night is now with him, nor carol blessed. Therefore the moon, the governess of floods, pale in her anger, washes all the air, that rheumatic diseases do abound, and it is thorough this distemperature we see the seasons alter. Hoary-headed frost fall in lap with crimson rose, and an old hind's thin and icy crown, an odorous chaplet of sweet summer buds, is, as in mockery, set. The spring, the summer, the childing autumn, angry winter fall in their wont liveries, and the mazed world by their increase knows not which is which. And this same progeny of evils comes from our debate, from our dissension. We are their parents and original.
Do you amend it, then? It lies in you. Why should Oberon cross his Titania? I do but beg the little changeling boy to be my henchman.
The fairyland buys not the child of me. I will not part with him.
How long within this wood intend you stay?
Oh, perchance till after Theseus' wedding day. If you will patiently dance in our rounds and see our moonlight revels go with us. If not, shun me and I will spare your haunts.
Give me that boy and I will go with
you. Not for thy fairy kingdom. Fairies away. We shall chide downright if I longer stay.
Well, go thy way. Thou shalt not from this grove till I torment thee for this injury. My gentle Puck, come hither. Thou hast seen, flying between the cold moon and the earth, Cupid, all armed. A certain aim he took at a fair vestal throned by the west and loosed his love shaft smartly from his bow as it should pierce 100,000 hearts. It fell upon a little western flower. The juice of it, once milk white, now purple with love's wound, and maidens call it love in idleness. Fetch me this flower. The herb which I showed thee once, the juice of it on sleeping eyelids laid, will make all man or woman madly dote upon the next live creature that it sees. Fetch me this herb. Be thou here again, ere the Leviathan can swim a league.
I'll put a girdle round about the earth in 40 minutes.
Once having this juice, I'll watch Oberon when he sleeps, then drop the liquor of it in his eyes. The next thing he, waking, looks upon, be it on lion or boar or wolf or on bear, on meddling monkey or on busy ape, he shall pursue it with the soul of love. And ere I take this charm from off his sight, as I can take it with another herb, he'll render up his page to me.
Demetrius!
But who comes here? I am invisible, and I will overhear their conference.
I love thee not, therefore pursue me not. Where is Lysander and fair Hermia? The one I'll stay, the other stayeth me. Thou told me they were stolen into the wood, and here I am, and would within this wood, because I cannot meet my Hermia.
Oh, you draw me, you hard-hearted adamant, and yet ye draw not iron, for my heart is true as steel. Leave you your power to draw, and I shall have no power to follow you.
Do I entice you? Do I speak you fair? Or rather, do I not in plainest truth tell you I do not and cannot love you?
And even for that do I love you the more. I am your spaniel, and Demetrius, the more you beat me, I will fawn on you.
Oh, attempt not too much the hatred of my spirit, for I am sick when I do look on thee.
And I am sick when I look not on thee.
I will not stay thy fawning. Let go, for if thou follow me, do not believe but I shall do thee mischief in the wood.
Aye, in the temple, in the town, in the field, you do me mischief. Fie, Demetrius! Your wrongs do set a scandal on my sex. We cannot fight for love as men do. We should be wooed, and we're not made to woo. I'll follow thee and make a heaven of hell to die upon the hand I love so well.
Fare thee well, nymph. Ere he do leave this grove, he shall fly him, and she shall seek thy love. Welcome, wanderer. I saw the flower there.
Aye, there it is.
I pray thee, give it me. I know a bank where the wild thyme blows, where oxlips and the nodding violet grows. There lies Oberon, some time of the night, lulled in these flowers with dances and delight. And there the snake throws her enameled skin, weed wide enough to wrap a fairy in. And with this juice, I'll streak his eyes and make him full of hateful fantasies. Take thou some of it and seek through this grove. An Athenian lady is in love with a disdainful youth. Anoint his eyes, but do it when the next thing he espises may be the lady. Thou shalt know the man by the Athenian garments he hath on. Affect this with some care so that he may prove more fond of her than she upon her love. And meet me ere the first cock crow.
Fear not, Fairy Queen. Your servant shall do so.
Come now. A roundel and a fairy song. Then, for the third part of a minute hence, some to kill cankers in the musk-rose buds, some war with rare mice for their leathern wings to make my small elves' coats, and some to keep back the clamorous owl that nightly hoots and wonders at our quaint spirits. Sing me now asleep, then to your offices and let me rest.
spotted snakes with double tongue. Newts and serpents, hide your sting. Newts and blind ones, do no wrong. Come not near our fairy king.
Philomel with melody, singing our sweet lullaby. Never harm, nor spell, nor charm. Come, our lovely master nigh. So good night with lullaby.
Weaving spiders, come not here. Hence, you long-legged spinners, hence. Beetles black, approach not near. Worm nor snail, do no offense.
Philomel with melody, singing our sweet lullaby. Never harm, nor spell, nor charm. Come, our lovely master nigh. So good night with lullaby.
Hence away, now all is well. One aloof stands sentinel.
What thou seest when thou doth wake, do it for thy true love's take. Love and languish for his sake, be it ounce or cat or bear, pard or boar with bristled hair. In thy eye thou shalt appear. When thou wakest, it is thy dear. Wake when some vile thing is near.
Fair love, you faint with wandering in the wood, and to speak troth, I have forgot our way. We'll rest this, Hermia, if you think it good, and tarry for the comfort of the day.
Be it so, Lysander. Find you out a bed, for I upon this bank shall rest my head.
One turf shall serve as a pillow for us both. One heart, one bed, two bosoms, and one trough.
Nay, good Lysander, for my sake, my dear, lie further off yet, not lie so near.
Take the sense, sweet, of my innocence. Love takes meaning in love's conference. I mean that my heart into yours is knit, so that but one heart we can make of it.
Lysander riddles very prettily. Now much beshrew my manners and my pride. Hermia meant to say Lysander lied. But, gentle friend, for love and courtesy, lie further off in human modesty. Such separation, as well may be said, becomes a virtuous bachelor and a maid. So far, be distant. And good night, sweet friend. May thy love never alter till thy sweet life end.
Here is my bed. Sleep give thee all his rest.
With half that wish, the wisher's eyes be pressed.
Through the forest have I gone, an Athenian found I none, whose eyes I might approve this flower's forest and stirring love. Oh, night and silence, who is here? Ah! Oh, weeds of Athens, he doth wear. This is he. My master said, despise the Athenian maid. And hear the maiden, sleeping sound on the dank and dirty ground. Pretty soul. She durst not lie nor this lack love, this kill courtesy. Sure upon thy eyes I throw all the power this charm doth owe. When thou wakest, let love forbid, sleep his seat on thy eyelid. And so awake, no shh, when I am gone. For I must now find a lover for Oberon.
Stay, though thou kill me, sweet Demetrius.
I charge thee hence, and do not haunt me thus.
Oh, would thou, darkling, leave me? Do not so.
Stay, on thy peril, I alone will go.
I'm out of breath in this fond chase. The more my prayer, the lesser is my grace. Happy is Hermia, wheresoe'er she lies, for she hath blessed and attractive eyes. But who is here? Lysander on the ground, dead or asleep. I see no blood, no wound. Lysander, if you live, good sir, awake!
And run through fire I will for thy sweet sake. Transparent Helena, nature shows art that through thy bosom makes me see thy heart. Where is Demetrius? Well, fit to word is that vile name to perish on my sword.
Oh, do not say so, Lysander, say not so. What though he love your Hermia? Lord, what though? Yet Hermia still loves you. Then be content.
Content with Hermia? No, I do repent. The tedious minutes with her I have spent. Not Hermia, but Helena I love. Who should not change a raven for a dove?
Wherefore was I to this keen mockery born? When, At your hand did I deserve this scorn. Is it not enough? Is it not enough, young man, that I did never, no, nor never can deserve a sweeter look from Demetrius's eye? But you must flout my insufficiency. Oh, that a lady of one man refused should of another therefore be abused.
She sees not Hermia. Hermia, sleep thou there. And never mayst thou come, Lysander, near. And all my powers dressing love in night to honor Helen and to be her knight.
Lysander? Lysander! What's going on? No! Lysander! No! Somebody help! Lysander! Where are you? Pray. Lysander? What, removed? Lysander? Lord? What, out of hearing? Gone? No sound, no word? No. Then I perceive you are not nigh. Either death or you will find immediately.
Place for our rehearsal.
Mrs. Quince.
What sayest thou, Bottom?
There are things in this comedy of Pyramus and Thisbe that will never please. First, Pyramus must draw a sword to kill himself? Which the ladies cannot abide by that?
A parlous fear he speaks true.
I feel we must leave all the killing out when all is done.
Not a whit. I have a device to make all well. Write me a prologue, and have the prologue seem to say that we do no harm with our swords. And for the better assurance, tell him that Pyramus is not Pyramus. That Pyramus is I, Nick Bottom, the weaver.
Well, we shall have such a prologue, and it will be written in 8 and 6.
No. Make it 2 more.
Why?
Let it be written in 8 and 8.
Will the ladies not be afraid of the lion?
I fear that as well.
Yes, you must consider to bring in with yourselves, God shield us, a lion amongst ladies is the most dreadful thing. For there's not a more terrible wildfowl than a living lion.
Therefore, another prologue must say that she is not a lion.
Nay. Half her face must be seen through the lion's neck, and she must speak, though, or saying thus to the same defect. Ladies!
Ladies!
Or, fair ladies!
Fair ladies!
I would wish you! Or I would entreat you not to fear, not to tremble. And there, tell them plainly, she is snug to join her.
Well, it shall be so, but there are 2 hard things. That is, to bring moonlight onto the stage, for you know Pyramus and Thisbe meet by moonlight.
Well, doth the moon shine that night we play our play?
A calendar. A calendar.
Oh.
Look in the almanac. Find out moonshine.
Okay, so how do you
it's upside down.
Find out moonshine.
Yes, it doth shine that night.
Then the moon may shine upon our stage.
Aye, or else one must come in with a lantern and bush of thorns and say they comes to disfigure or to present the person of moonshine. But then there is another thing. We must have a wall in the great garden, for, says the story, Pyramus and Thisbe talk through the chink of a wall.
You can never bring in a wall. What say you, Bottom?
Well, some man or other must present wall. and let them have some loam or some rough cast about them to signify wall. Or let them hold their fingers thus, and through the chink, Pyramus and Thisbe shall whisper.
Well, if that may be, then all is well. Come, sit down and rehearse your parts. Pyramus, you begin. Once you have spoken your speech, enter into that break, and so shall everyone according to his cue. What happened, Homespuns? Have we swaggering here? What, so near the cradle of the fairy king? What, a play toward? I'll be an auditor. An actor, too, perhaps, if I see cause. Pyramus, speak. Thisbe, stand forth.
Thisbe, the flowers of odious savor.
Odors.
Thisbe, the flowers of odors, savor sweet. So stay thee here a while, and half thy breath, to thee I will appear.
A stranger Pyramus than ever played here.
Must I speak now?
Aye, Mary, must you? For you must understand, he goes but to hear a noise, and is to come again.
Most radiant Pyramus, most lily white of hue, my color of red rose on most triumphant briar, most brisky juvenile, or eke most lovely Jew, as true as truest horse, that yet would never tire. I'll meet thee, Pyramus, at Ninny's tomb.
Ninny's tomb, man, you mustn't speak that yet. That you answer to Pyramus. You speak all your parts at once, cues and all. Pyramus, enter, your cue is past, it's never tire.
As true as truest horse that yet would never tire.
If I were, Batman, these be only thine.
Oh, monstrous, oh, strange, we're haunted. Pry masters, fly masters. I'll follow you. I'll lead you about around, through bog, through bush, through brake, through briar. Sometime a horse I'll be, sometime a hound, a hog, a headless bear, a fire, and neigh, and bark, and grunt, and roar, and burn, as horse, hound, hog, bear, fire at every turn.
Why do they run away? This is the knavery of them to make me afeard.
Bottom, thou art changed. What do I see on thee?
What do you see? An ass out of your own, do you?
Bless thee, Bottom. Bless thee, thou art translated!
No. No, I see their knavery. This is to make me afeard. Ha, if they could. But I will not stir from this place. I will walk up and down here to show them I am not afraid. And I shall sing. The ouzel cock, though black of hue, with orange tawny bill, the throstle with his note so true, the wren with little quill.
What angel wakes me from my flowery bed?
Oh, the finch, the sparrow, and the lark that plays on cuckoo gray, whose noble many a man doth mark and dares not answer nay.
Oh, I pray thee, gentle mortal, sing again. Mine ear is much enamored of thy note, so is mine eye enthralled to thy shape. And thy virtues force perforce doth move me to be the first to say, to swear, I love thee.
Methinks you should have little reason for that, monsieur. But the truth is, reason and love keep little company nowadays.
Well, thou art as wise as thou art beautiful.
Not so neither. But if I'd enough wit to get out of this wood, I'd enough to serve my own turn.
Out of this wood do not desire to go. Thou shalt remain here whether thou wilt or no. I am a spirit of no common rate. The earth doth tend upon my state. And I do love thee. Therefore go with me. And I shall give thee fairies to attend on thee, and they shall fetch thee jewels from the deep and sing while thou on pressed flowers dost sleep. And I will purge thy mortal grossness so that thou shalt like an airy spirit go. Well, peas blossom, cobweb, moth, and mustard seed.
Ready.
And I.
Oh, my God.
Where shall we go?
Be kind and courteous to this gentleman. Hop in his walks and gambol in his eyes.
Feed him with apricots and dewberries, with purple grapes, green figs, and mulberries. The honey bags steal from the humble bees, and for night tapers, crop in their waxen thighs, and light them at the fiery glowworm's eyes to have my love to bed and to arise, and pluck the wings from painted butterflies to fan the moonbeams from his sleeping eyes. Nod to him, elves, and do him courtesies.
Hail, mortal.
Hail.
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 Heartily, I beseech thy worship's mercy, but what is thy worship's name?
Cobweb.
Good master Cobweb. If I cut my finger, I shall make bold with you. I desire more acquaintance of you. I beseech thee. And your name, honest fairy?
Peace Blossom.
Good master Peace Blossom. Commend me to your father, Master Peascod, and your mother, Mistress Squash. I desire more acquaintance of you. I beseech thee. And your name, honest fairy?
Mustard Seed.
Good Master Mustard Seed. I know your patience well. That same cowardly giant-like ox beef hath devoured many a man of your house. No, no. But I promise, your kindred hath made my eyes water here now. I beseech thee. And your name, honest fairy?
Moth.
Good master Moth. I shall be thy light, and like Moth, you shall follow me. I beseech thee.
Come now, lead him to my bower. The moon, methinks, looks on with watery eye, and when she weeps, weeps every little flower, lamenting some enforced chastity. Tie up my lover's tongue. Bring him silently.
Oberon be awakened. Then what it was that next came in his eye, which he must dote on in extremity. Oh, here comes my messenger. How now, mad spirit? What night rule now about this haunted grove?
My master, with a monster, is in love. Near to his close and consecrated bower, while he was in his dull and sleeping hour, a crew of patches, rude mechanicals, who work for bread upon Athenian stalls, were met together to rehearse a play intended for great Theseus' nuptial day, the shallowest thick skin of their barren sort, whom Pyramus presented in their sport, forsook his scene and entered in a break. What I did him at disadvantage take, an ass's knoll I fixed on his head. Anon his thisbe must be answered. Forth my mimic comes when they him spy, as wild geese that the creeping fowler eye, a russet pated chows, many in sort, rising and calling at the guns' report, sever themselves and madly sweep the sky. For at his sight, away his fellows fly, and at our stamp, here and o'er one falls. He murder cries, and help from Athens calls. Their sense, thus weak, lust with their fears, thus strong, made senseless things begin to do them wrong. For briars and thorns at their apparel snatch, some sleeves, some hats, some yielders, all things catch. I led them on in this distracted fear, and left sweet Pyramus translated there, when in that moment, so it came to pass, Oberon waked, and straightway loved an ass.
Oh, this falls out better than I could devise. Oh. But hast thou yet latched the Athenian's eyes with the love juice as I did bid thee do?
Mm-hmm. I took him sleeping. That is finished too. And the Athenian woman by his side, that when he waked, of course, she must be eyed.
Hermia! Stand close. This is the same Athenian.
Well, this is the woman, but not this the man.
Why do you rebuke him that loves you so? Lay breath so bitter on your bitter foe.
Now I betide, but I should use thee worse, for thou, I fear, hast given me the cause to curse.
thou hast slain Lysander in his sleep, being o'ershoes in blood, and plunge in the deep, and kill me too. Good Demetrius, will thou give him me?
I'd rather give his carcass to my hounds.
Out dog, out cur! Thou hast driven me past the bounds of maiden's patience. Hast thou slain him then?
I am not guilty of Lysander's blood, nor is he dead for aught that I can tell.
I pray thee, tell me then that he is well.
And if I could, what would I get there for?
A privilege never to see me more, and from my hated presence part I so. See me no more, whether he be dead or no.
There is no following her in this fierce vein. Oh, here therefore for a while I will remain. So sorrow's heaviness doth heavier grow. For debt that sleep bankrupt doth sorrow owe, which now in some slight measure will pay. Oh, if for here is tender, I make some stay.
What hast thou done? Thou hast mistaken quite, and laid the love juice on some true love sight. Of thy misprison must perforce ensue some true love turned, and on a false turned true.
Then fate o'errules that. One man holding truth, a million fail, confounding oath on oath.
About the wood, go swifter than the wind, and Helena of Athens look thou find. All fancy sick she is, and pale of cheer, with sighs of love that cost the fresh blood dear. By some illusion, see thou bring her here. I'll charm his eyes against she do appear.
I go. I go. Oh, look how I go. Swifter than arrow from the Tartar's bow.
Flower of thy purple dye, hit with Cupid's archery. Sink in apple of his eye, when his love he doth espy, let her shine as gloriously as the Venus of the sky. When thou wakest, if she be by, beg of her for remedy.
Captain of our fairy band, Helena is here at hand, and the youth, mistook by me, pleading for a lover's fee. Or shall we their fond pageant see? Lord, what fools these mortals be!
Stand aside. The noise they make will cause Demetrius to awake.
Why should you think that I should woo in scorn? Scorn in derision of her coming tears.
These vows are Hermia's. Will you give her o'er? We oath with oath, and you will nothing weigh. Your vows to her and me put in two scales will even weigh, and both as light as tales.
I had no judgment when to her I swore.
Nor none in my mind, now you give her o'er.
Demetrius loves her, and he loves not you.
Oh, Helen! Goddess! Nymph perfect divine! To what, my love, shall I compare thine eyne? Crystal is muddy. How ripe and shoal thy kissing cherries tempting grow!
Oh, spite! Oh, hell! I see you all are bent to set against me for your merriment. If you were civil and knew courtesy, you would not do me thus much injury. Can you not hate me, as I know you do, but you must join in souls to mock me too? If you were men, as men you are in show, you would not use a gentle lady so.
You are unkind, Demetrius, be not so, for you love Hermia, this you know, I know. And with all my heart, and all the best love in my, and Hermia's love, I yield you up my heart.
Never did mockers waste more idle breath.
Lysander, keep thy Hermia, I will none. If ever I loved her, all that love is gone.
Helen, it is not so.
Look where thy love comes. Yonder is thy dear.
Lysander, why unkindly didst thou leave me so?
Why should he stay whom love doth press to go?
What love can press Lysander from my side?
Lysander's love, that would not let him bide. Fair Helena, who more anglets the night than all yon fiery o's and eyes of light.
You speak not as you think, it cannot be.
Lo, she is one of the confederacy. Now I perceive they have conjoined all three to fashion this false sport and scorn at me.
I scorn you not. It seems that you scorn me.
If you have any pity, grace, or manners, you would not make me such an argument. But fare you well.
Stay, gentle Helena. Hear my excuse. My love, my life, my soul. Fair Helena.
Oh, excellent. Please do not scorn her so.
Helena, I love thee. By my life I do. And to that which I will lose for thee, to prove him false who says I love thee not.
Well, I say I can love thee more than he can do.
If thou say so, withdraw and prove it too.
Quick. Come.
Lysander, where's the tenzel?
Away, you leech!
No, no, he'll seem to break loose. Take on as you would come, but yet come not. You are a tame man, go!
Hang off, thou cat, thou burr. Vile thing, let loose or I will shake thee from me like a serpent.
Why are you grown so rude? What change is this, sweet love?
Thy love? Ours loathed medicine, oh hated potion, hence?
Do you not jest?
No, soothe, and so do you.
Demetrius, I will keep my word with thee.
A weak bond holds you, I'll not trust your word.
What? Should I hurt her, strike her, kill her dead? Although I hate her, I will not harm her so.
What, can you do me greater harm than hate? Hate me? For me, what news, my love? Am I not Hermia? Are you not Lysander?
Aye, by my life. I never did desire to see thee more. Therefore, be out of question, of hope, of doubt. Be certain nothing truer. 'Tis no jest that I do hate thee. And love Helena.
Oh, me. You, juggler. You, canker blossom. You thief of love! What? Have you gone by night and stolen my love's heart from him?
Have you no modesty, no maiden shame, no touch of bashfulness?
What?
Will you tear impatient answers from my gentle tongue? Fie, fie, you counterfeit, you puppet, you...
A puppet? Why so? Why, that way goes the game. Are you grown so high in his esteem because I am so dwarfish and so low? How low am I, thou painted maple? Speak! How low am I? I am not yet so low, but that my nails cannot reach unto thine's eyes!
Oh, I pray you, but you must be gentlemen, let him not hurt me. I have no gift at all in shrewishness. I am a right maid for my cowardice. Let her not strike me. You perhaps may think because she is something lower than myself that I can match her.
Lower? Hark again!
Good Hermia, do not be so bitter with me. I evermore did love you, Hermia. Did ever keep your counsels? Never wronged you? Save that in love unto Demetrius. I told him of your stealth unto this wood. He followed you, and for love I followed him. But he hath chid me hence, and threatened me to strike me, spurn me, nay, to kill me too. And now, so you will let me quiet go. To Athens will I bear my folly back.
I get you gone. Who is that hinders you?
A foolish heart that I leave here behind.
What? With Lysander?
With Demetrius!
Be not afraid, Helena. She shall not harm thee. Oh,
no, sir, she shall not, though you take her part.
When she is angry, she is keen and shrewd. She was a vixen when we went to school. And though she be but little, she is fierce.
Little again? Nothing but low and little. Why will you suffer her to flout me thus? Let me come to her.
Get you gone, you dwarf. You minimus, not grass maid. You bee, you acorn.
You are too officious to her that scorned your services. Speak not of Helena. For if thou dost intend never so little show of love to her, thou shalt abide it.
Demetrius!
Lysander! You puppet! You coward!
I love her more!
Get her out!
You acorn!
Get out of here, dwarf!
Counterfeit!
Now she holds me not. Now follow if thou darest to prove who's right. Of thine or mine is most in Helena.
Follow. Nay. I'll go with thee, cheek by jowl!
You, mistress, all this coil is long of you. Nay, go not back.
I will not trust you. I nor longer stay in your cursed company. Your hands than mine are quicker for a fray. My legs are longer, though, to run away.
I am amazed and know not what to say.
This is thy negligence.
Still thou mistakest, or else commit thy knaveries willfully.
Believe me, Queen of Shadows, I mistook. Did not you tell me I should know the man by the, and I quote, Athenian garments he hath on? So far, blameless proves my enterprise I have anointed on Athenian's eyes, and so far, my glad it so did sort. Is this their jangling I esteem a sport?
Seest thou, these lovers seek a place to fight. Hie, therefore, Robin, overcast the night. The starry welkin cover thou anon with drooping fog as black as Acheron, and lead these testy rivals so astray as one come not within another's way. Like to Lysander, sometime frame thy tongue, then stir Demetrius up with bitter wrong. And sometime rail thou like Demetrius.
No.
And from each other look thou lead them doth. Till over their brows death counterfeiting sleep with leaden legs and batty wings doth creep. Then crush this herb inlet to Lysander's eyes, whose liquor has such virtuous property to take from thence all error with his mic and make his eyeballs roll with wonted sight. When next they wake, all this derision shall seem a dream and fruitless vision, and back to Athens shall the lovers wend with league whose date till death shall never end. Whilst I in this derision do thee employ, I'll to my king and beg his Indian boy. Then I'll his charmed eye release from monster's view, and all things shall be peace. But notwithstanding, haste, make no delay. We may effect this business yet ere day.
Up and down. Up and down. I will lead them up and down. I am feared in field and town. Robin, lead them up and down. Here comes one.
Where art thou, proud Dimitri? Speak thou now.
Here, villain, drawn and ready. Guard thou.
I will be with thee straight.
Follow me then to plainer ground.
Lysander, speak again. Thou run away, thou coward, art thou fled? Where dost thou hide thy head? Speak. Where art thou?
Follow my voice, but try not to hear.
He goes before me and still dares me on. I come where he goes, then he is gone. The villain is much lighter heeled than I. I followed fast, but faster he did fly. I've fallen in my dark, uneven way. And here will rest me. Come now, gentle day. For if but once thou show me thy great light, I'll find Demetrius and revenge this spite.
Thou, abide me if thou darest, for well would thou runnest before me, shifting every place, and darest not stand nor look me in the face. Where art thou now?
Come hither! I am here.
Nathan, thou mockest me. Thou shalt buy this dear if ever I thy face by daylight see. Now go thy way. Faintness constraineth me to measure out my length on this cold bed. By day's approach, look to be visited.
A weary night, a long and tedious night, abate thy hours. Shine comforts from the east, that I may back to Athens by daylight from these that my poor company detest. And sleep, that sometimes shuts up sorrow's eye, steal me a while from mine own company.
Yet but three. Oh, come one more! Well, two of both kinds makes up four. Here she comes, curse and sad. Cupid is a knavish lad, thus to make poor maidens mad.
Never so weary, never so in woe, dabbled with the dew and torn with briars. I can no further crawl, no further go. My legs can keep no pace with my desires. Here will I rest me till break of day. Heaven shield Lysander if they mean a fray.
On the ground, sleep sound.
I'll apply to your eye, gentle lover. Remedy. When thou wakest, thou takest true delight in the sight of thy fee's eye. In the country proverb known, that every man shall have his own. Jack shall have Jill, naught shall go ill. The man will have his mare again. And all shall be well.
Down upon this flowery bed, while I thy amiable cheeks do coy, and sick musk roses in thy sleek smooth head, and kiss thy fair large ears, my gentle joy.
Where's Cobweb?
Ready.
Scratch my head, Cobweb. And where's Monsieur Mustard Seed?
Ready.
Good Monsieur. Get your weapons in your hand and kill me a red-hipped humblebee on the top of a thistle. And good monsieur, bring me the honey bag. Where's Moth?
Ready.
Give me your neef, Monsieur Moss. Pray you leave your courtesy.
What's your will?
Nothing but to help Cavalry Cobweb scratch. I am such a tender ass, if my hair do tickle me, I must scratch it. And where's Peas Blossom?
Yes, Master Bottom.
I have a reasonable good taste in music. Let's have the tongs and the bones.
Say, sweet love, what thou desirest to eat?
Truly, a peck of provender. I could munch your good dry oats. Methinks I have a great desire for a bottle of hay. Good hay, sweet hay hath no fellow.
I have a venturous fairy that shall seek the squirrel's hoard and fetch thee new nuts.
I'd rather a handful or two of your dried peas. But let your people not stir me, for I have an exhibition of sleep come upon me.
Sleep thou, and I will wind thee in my arms. Fairies, be gone! And be all ways away. So doth the woodbine and sweet honeysuckle gently entwist. The female ivy so and rings the barky fingers of the elm. Oh, how I love thee! How I dote on thee!
welcome, good Robin. Seest thou this sweet sight? His dotage now I do begin to pity. And now I have the boy, I will undo this hateful imperfection of his eyes. And, gentle Puck, take this transformed scalp from off the head of this Athenian swain, so that he, waking when the others do, may all to Athens back again repair, and think no more of this night's accidents, but as a fierce vexation of a dream. But first, I shall release the fairy king. Be as thou wast won't be. See as thou wast won't see. Diane's bud over Cupid's flower has such force and blessed power. Now wake you, my sweet king.
My Titania, what visions I have seen. Methought I was enamored of an ass.
Well, there lies your love.
How came these things to pass? How mine eyes do loathe his visage now.
Silence a while. Robin, take off his head. Oberon, music calls of these common sleep, of these sleep the five of the sense.
Music. Oh, music such as charmeth sleep.
Now, when thou wakest, with thine own fool's eyes peep.
Sound music. Come, my king, take hands with me and rock the ground whereon these sleepers be.
Fairy queen, attendant mark, for I do hear the morning lark.
Then, my lord, in silence sad, trip we after the night's shade. We the globe can compass soon, swifter than the wandering moon.
Come, my queen, and in our flight tell me how it came this night, that I sleeping here was found with these mortals on the ground.
When my cue comes, call me. My next is, as fair Pyramus. Hello? Mrs. Quince? Flute, the bellows mender. Starveling. Stolen hence and left me asleep. I have had a most rare vision. I've had a dream past the wit of man to say what dream it was. Man is but an ass if you were about to go expound this dream, but methought I was. There's no man that can tell me what methought I was, but methought I was and methought I had. There's no man that can tell me what methought I had. The eye of man hath not heard. Man's ears not able to see, his hand to taste, his tongue to conceive, or his heart tell me what my dream was. I will get Mrs. Quince to write a ballad of this dream. It shall be called Bottom's Dream, for it hath no bottom, and I shall sing it in the latter end of the play. Peradventure, to make it the more gracious, I will sing it at her death.
Thank you.
one of you find out the forest. For now our observation is performed. And since we have the vayward of the day, my love shall hear the music of my hounds uncouple in the western valley. Let them go. Dispatch, I say, and find out the forester. We will, fair queen, up to mountain's top, and mark the musical confusion of my hounds and echo in conjunction.
I was with Hercules and Cadmus once when, in a wood of Crete, they bayed the bears with hounds of Sparta. Never did I hear such gallant chiding, for besides the groves, the skies, the fountains, every region near seemed all one mutual cry. I never heard so musical a discord, such sweet thunder.
My hounds are bred out of Spartan kind, so flued, so sanded, with their heads hung, with ears that sweep away the morning dew. But soft, what nymphs are these?
This is my daughter here asleep, and this is Lysander. This Demetrius is, and this is Helena, old Neater's Helena. I wonder if they're being here.
No doubt they rose up early to observe the rite of May, but hearing our intent came here in grace of our solemnity. Oh, but speak, Aegeus. Is not this the day Hermia's to give answer of her choice?
It is, my lord.
Go, bid the huntsmen wake them with their horns. Good morrow, friends. Saint Valentine is past, but these wood birds but to couple now?
Pardon, my lord.
I pray you all stand up. I know you two are rival enemies. How comes such gentle a concord in the world, that hatred is so far from jealousy, to sleep by hate and feel no enmity?
My lord, I shall reply amazedly, half awake, half sleeping, but as yet I swear, I cannot truly say how I came here. I came Hermia hither. Our intent was to be gone from Athens, where we might, without the peril of the Athenian law.
Enough! Enough, my lord. You have enough. I beg the law. The law upon his head. They would have stolen away. They would, Demetrius. Thereby to have defeated both you and me. You of your wife, and me of my consent. My consent that she should be your wife.
My lord, fair Helen told me of their stealth. For this their purpose hither to the wood, and I in fury hither followed them, for Helen fancying following me. But, my lord, I wot not by what power, but by some power it is, my love for Hermia melted as the snow. Seems to me now as the remembrance of an idol god which in my childhood I did dote upon. And now the virtue, the object and the pleasure of mine eye is only Helena. To her, my lord, as I betrothed, there I saw Hermia, but like a sickness did I loathe this food. But as in health come to my natural taste, now I do wish it, love it, long for it, and will forevermore be true to it.
Mrs. Quinn!
Gods!
Flute! The bellows mender! Snout the tinker! I'm sorry, but if you...
Theseus!
Right. I apologize, good sir, but... Whomever it is you are looking for, we have not seen.
I apologize.
Mrs. Quint! Fair lovers, you are fortunately met. This discourse we more will hear anon. Aegeus, I overbear your will.
My lord!
I overbear your will. For in temple, by and by with us, you couples shall be knit. And for the morning now is something worn. Our purposed hunting shall be set aside. Away with us to Athens. Three and three. We'll hold a feast in great solemnity. Come, Hippolyta.
Things seem so small and undistinguishable, like far-off mountains turned into clouds.
Methinks I see these things with parted eyes, and everything seems double.
So methinks, and I have found Demetrius like a jewel, mine own and not my own.
Are you sure that we are awake? I mean, it seems to me that if we sleep, we dream. Do you not think the Duke was just here and bid us follow him?
Yes, and my father.
And Hippolyta.
And he did bid us follow to the temple.
Why, then we are awake. Let us go. And by the way, let us recount our dreams.
Been heard of. Out of doubt, he has been transported.
No, if bottom come not, then our play is marred. It goes not forward, doth it?
It is not possible. There is not a man in all Athens able to discharge Pyramus, but he.
No,
he had simply the best wood of any handicraftsman in Athens.
Yes.
And the best person, too. He is my very paramour for a sweet voice.
Masters. The Duke is coming from the temple, and there's two or three lords or ladies more married. Oh, if our sport would have gone on, we would have been made.
Oh, no! Sweet! Holy bottom! Thus had he lost sixpence a day during his life. He could not escape sixpence a day. And the Duke had not given him sixpence a day for playing Pyramus. I'll be hanged! Oh, you would have deserved it! Sixpence a day in Pyramus or nothing.
Where are these lads? Where are these hearts? Masters, masters, I am to discourse wonders. But ask me not what, for if I tell you, I am not a true Athenian. I will tell you everything right as it fell out.
Oh, let us hear, sweet bottom.
Not a word of me, for all I will tell you is, the Duke hath died. Gather your apparel, new strings to your beards, and new ribbons to your pumps, for the short and the long is, our play is preferred.
My play? It's preferred. It's preferred. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God. Oh my God.
Case, let him that plays Thisbe have clean linen, and let her that plays the lion not pare their nails, for they shall hang out as the lion's claws. And most dear actors, eat no onion nor garlic, for we are to utter sweet breath. For there's no doubt but to hear them say it is an utter sweet comedy. No more words, away, go away!
Fables nor these fairy toys. Lovers and madmen have such seething brains, such shaping fancies that apprehend more than cool reason ever comprehends.
Oh, but all the stories of their night told over and all their minds transfigured so together, more withstanding than fancy's images, and grows to that of great constancy, but howsoever strange and admirable.
Oh, here come those you speak of. Joy, gentle friends, join. May fresh days of love accompany your hearts.
More than to us. We wait in your royal ward, your walk, your bed.
Oh, come, what mask shall we wear this evening? What shall we do to ease the anguish of these 3 hours between our after supper and bedtime? Where's our usual manager of mirth? Are there no revels in hand? Is there no play to ease the anguish of a torturing hour? Come, Philostrate!
Hear, mighty Theseus!
Say, what abridgments have you for this evening?
There are brief how many sports are ripe. Make choice of what your highness will see first.
A tedious brief scene of young Pyramus and his love Thisbe, very tragical merry mirth. Merry and tragical. Tedious and brief. Why, that is hot ice and wondrous strange snow. How shall we find the concord of this discord?
A play there is, my lord, some 10 words long, which is as brief as I've known a play. But 10 words, my lord, it is too long. For in all the play there is not 1 word apt, 1 player fitted, and tragical, my noble lord, it is. For Pyramus therein doth kill himself, which, when I saw rehearsed, I must confess, made mine eyes water. But more merry tears, the passion of loud laughter never shed.
What are they that do play it?
Hard-headed men that work in Athens, here, which never labored in their minds till now, and have toiled their unbreathed memories with this same play against your nuptial.
And we will hear it.
No! Oh, my noble lord, it's not for you. I've heard it over.
I will hear that play! For never anything could be amiss when simpleness and duty tender it.
Oh. Yes, noble lord.
I love not to see wretchedness overcharged and duty in his service perishing.
Oh, you shall see no such thing.
He says they can do nothing in this kind.
Well, the kind are we. To give them thanks for nothing. Our sport shall be to take what they mistake, and what poor duty cannot do, noble respect takes and might not merit. Love, therefore, and tongue-tied simplicity, in least speaks most to my capacity.
So please, your grace, the prologue is addressed.
Let her approach.
Ow, 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 God. Shut up, shut up, shut up!
If we offend, it is with our goodwill. That in which we come not to offend, but with goodwill, to show our simple skill, that is the true beginning of our end. Consider then, we come but in despite. We do not come as minding to content you. Our true intent is all for your delight. We are not here, that in which you should here repent you. The actors are at hand, and by their show you shall know all that you are like to know.
This prologue doth not stand upon a single point.
Shh, shut up!
Music. Gentles, perchance you wonder at this show, but wonder on, till truth makes all things plain. This man is Pyramus, if you would know. This beauteous lady, Thisbe, is certain. This man, with lime and rough cast, doth present wall. That vile wall in which these lovers did sunder. And through wall's chink, poor souls, they are content to whisper, at the which let no man wonder. This man, with lantern, dog, and bush of thorn, presented moonshine, for if you would know, these lovers did think no scorn to meet at Nina's tomb, there to woo. Oh. This grisly beast, which lion hight by name, the trusty Thisbe, coming first by night, did scare away, or rather did affright. And as she fled, her mantle she did fall, which lion, vile with bloody mouth, did stain. Anon comes Pyramus, sweet youth and tall, to find his trusty Thisbe's mantle slain. Whereat with blade, with bloody, blameful blade, he bravely broached his boiling, bloody breast. And Thisbe, tarring in mulberry shade, his dagger drew and died. For all the rest, let lion, moonshine, wall, and lovers twain, at large discourse, here they do remain.
The lion be to speak.
Well, no wonder, my lady. One lion may when many asses do.
In the same interlude, it doth befall that I, once not by name, present a wall. And such a wall as I would have you think had in it a crannied hole or chink, in which the lovers Pyramus and
Frisbee did whisper very secretly, this loam, this roughness, and this stone doth show that I am that same wall. The truth is so, and this cranny is right and sinister, in which the fearful lovers are to whisper. That's your cue.
Oh, night, oh, night, with hue so black. Oh, night, which art when day is not. Alack, alack, alack. I fear my Thisbe's promises. Alack, alack, alack. I fear my Thisbe's promises.
Forgot.
Yeah, I know I forgot.
No, you idiot, the word is forgot.
I fear my Thisbe's promise is forgot. And thou, O wall, O sweet and lovely wall, that stands between her father's ground and mine. And thou, O wall, O sweet and lovely wall, show me thine chink to blink through with mine eye. Thanks, courteous wall. Just shield thee well for this. But what do I see? No Thisbe do I see. Cursed be the stones of this vile wall through whom I see no bliss for thus deceiving me.
Oh, wall, full often have you heard my moans for parting my fair Pyramus and me. How often have these cherry lips kissed thy stones with hair and lime knit up in thee?
I see a voice, now the chink, and I can hear my Thisbe's face. Thisbe!
My love! Thou art my love, I think.
Wilt thou kiss me through the hole of this vile wall?
I kiss the wall's hole, not your lips at all.
Wilt thou meet me at Ninny's tomb straightway?
Ninus!
Wilt thou at Ninus's tomb meet me straightway?
Tied life, tied death. What come without delay?
Okay. Oh. Oh my God! They fell! Oh my God! I just
Stop it!
I'm sorry. I hate you guys.
Thus have I, wall, my part discharged so, and being done, thus wall away doth go. I'm here every Thursday, guys. Come on. Okay. Come on.
I'm sorry. It's a big wall. It's a big
this
wall.
This is the strangest stuff that ever I heard.
The best in this kind are shadows, and the worst no worse if imagination amend them.
It must be your imagination, then, and not theirs.
Well, if we imagine them no worse than they do of themselves, they may pass for excellent men. But here come two noble beasts, a man and a lion.
You, ladies, you fair ladies, you whose gentle hearts do fear the smallest monstrous mouse that creeps on floor, may now perchance both quake and tremble here. When lion rough in wildest rage doth roar, then know that I, Snug the Joiner, am.
This lantern doth the horned moon present.
You should have worn the horns on your head.
This lantern doth the horned moon present. Myself, the met woman in the moon do seem to be.
Oh, this is the greatest star of all the rest. The man should be put inside the lanthorn. How is it the woman in the moon?
I'm weary of this moon, which she would change.
Proceed. All I have to say is to tell that this lantern is the moon.
God.
Oh. Myself, the woman in the moon. This thorn bush, my thorn bush. And this dog, my dog.
It's a cat. Wait, this is old Ninny's tomb.
Ninus's!
This is old Ninus's tomb. Where is my love?
Oh!
It's immersive. Well run, Thisbe.
Well shown, moon. Truly, the moon shines with grace.
Then came Pyramus. And so I vanished.
Thank thee, moon, for thy sunny beams. Thank thee, moon, for shining now so bright. Thank thee for thy gracious golden glittering gleams. I trust to take thy truest Thisbe sight. But stay, O spite. But mark, poor knight, what dreadful dole is here. Thy mantle good, what? Stained with blood. Oh, dainty duck, oh dear. How can it be? Eyes, do you see? Oh, approach, ye furies fell. Come, come, cut thread and thrum. Quail, crush, conclude, and quell. Aye, by that pap. That left pap of Pyramus, where a heart doth hop.
No. No. No!
Now I am dead. Now I am fled. Thy soul is in the sky. Tongue, loose thy light. Moon, take thy flight. Moon, take thy flight. And die. Die. Die.
By Charlotte. Oh, here she comes, and her passion ends the play.
Oh, methinks she should be brief for such a Pyramus. I hope she'll be brief.
Asleep, my love? What, dead, my dove? Oh, Pyramus, arise! Speak, speak. Quite dumb? Dead, dead, a tomb must cover thy sweet eyes. These lily lips, this cherry nose, these yellow cowslip cheeks are gone. Are gone. Lovers, make moan. His eyes were green as leeks. Oh, sisters three, come. Come to me with hands as pale as milk. Lay them in gore, since you have shore with shears his thread of silk. Tongue, not a word. Come, trusty sword. Come, blade, my breast and brew. And farewell, my friends. Thus, this be ends. Adieu, adieu, adieu.
Shut off.
What?
Shut off. Shut off.
How?
Shut it off. Here, well, shut it off.
Why don't you?
Why just shut it off? Shut it off!
Turn it off, man!
Shut it off!
No,
yes! Yes! Yes!
Bye! Will it please to see an epilogue?
No! No epilogue, I pray you, for your play needs no excuse! Never excuse! For a fine tragedy this has been, so leave the epilogue alone, and let the festivities begin!
Bring the beat in! See the stars all the way from here. Can't you see them?
the hungry lion roars. And the wolf bowls the moon. Whilst the heavy plowman snores all with weary task foredone. Now the wasted brands do glow, whilst the screech owl screeching loud puts the wretch that lies in woe in remembrance of a shroud. Now it is the time of night that the graves all gaping wide. Everyone lets forth his sprite. In the churchway paths to glide, and we fairies that do run by the triple Hecate's team from the presence of the sun, following darkness like a dream. Now our frolic. Not a mouse shall disturb this hallowed house. I am sent with broom before. Sweep the dust behind the door.
Now, until the break of day, through this house each fairy stray.
To disobey capacity, which by us shall blessed be.
And the issue there create ever shall be fortunate. So shall all this company ever true and living be.
And all the strains of nature's hand shall not in their issue stand.
Never shew in frictious law retort.
To clock-tick drag shan't time resort.
Love and choice as normalcy.
Shall this true existence be?
Create control, not control create.
Every fairy take their gate.
And each several chamber bless.
In this palace with sweet peace.
And the owner of it blessed.
Ever shall in safety rest.
Trip away, make no stay.
Meet me all by break of day.
Shadows have offended. Well, think but this, and all is mended. That we have but slumbered here. While these visions did appear, and this weak and idle theme. No more yielding, but a dream. Our gentles, do not reprehend. If we pardon, we will mend. And as I am, an honest Houck. If we have unearned luck, now to scape the serpent's tongue. And we will make amends ere long. Else the Puck a liar call. So, good night to you all. Hands, if we be friends. Then Robin shall restore amends.